Will future technological shifts make cities obsolete? 25 years ago, this was a popular view among the cyberseers and technopundits who made a living telling the world its future. They argued that new forms of information technology, in those days that meant the fax machine, were making it easier and easier to communicate over long distances. That meant that we could connect with each other from far away. Hence, we didn't need face-to-face contact. And hence, we didn't need the cities that enable that contact. The future would all be telecommuting. We would work in electronic cottages, enjoying all the benefits of nature and privacy, and just dial it in. After all, the 20th century's improvements in transportation technology had moved industry out of the city. Why shouldn't 21st century improvements in communications technology move the people out of the city? When I started working on this topic more than 20 years ago, this line of reasoning seemed a bit suspicious to me. The futurists could be right, but it seemed to me that they could also be wrong. I first reframed the question so it sounded more like economics. Are electronic interactions complements or substitutes for face-to-face interactions? If two things are substitutes, then if one thing, electronic interactions, gets cheaper and better, then we do less of the other thing, face-to-face interactions. If two things are complements, then if one thing gets cheaper and better, we do more, not less of the other thing. Based on my own life experience, it seemed quite possible that electronic interactions were complements, not substitutes, for face-to-face interactions. Sure, sometimes I would use a phone instead of meeting face-to-face, but generally, I needed to call someone to meet with them. Data from the phone company backed me up. Callers generally phoned people who lived close to them, not people who lived far away. Maybe, as telecommunications improves, we build more relationships, and each relationship involves a combination of face-to-face and electronic interaction. If new technologies create a far more interactive world, then there could easily be more demand for face-to-face contact and for cities. The claim that technology was increasing the number of relationships seemed to be supported by the rising number of co-authored papers in economics and other disciplines. The rising importance of face-to-face contact was also shown by the vast increase in the amount of business travel during those years, despite the availability of the fax machine. Since I first wrote about this topic, I've come to think that there are three other reasons why globalization and new technologies may be increasing the demand for cities. First, these global shifts have radically increased the returns to being smart. Hundreds of studies have shown big increases in the wage premium enjoyed by workers who have more years of schooling or higher test scores since the 1970s. Human beings are a social species, and we get smart by being around other smart people. We learn things by being in cities, and as the returns to learning increases, so does the demand for cities. Second, the world is becoming far more complicated. As ideas grow in complexity, it becomes easier for them to get lost in translation. Anyone who has ever taught knows the hard part about teaching isn't knowing your subject material. It's knowing whether anything you're saying is getting through to your students. We have evolved over millions of years to have cues that communicate comprehension or confusion, and those cues are lost when we are not in the same room with one another. I have no idea if you're currently listening or paying attention to what I'm saying. I would in a classroom. Third, a better educated and wealthier world craves higher end pleasures, like live performance and cutting edge restaurants. Those pleasures aren't disproportionately available in cities. Moreover, technology itself, in the form of Uber and Yelp, is improving urban life. Now, these are all arguments why the futurists might be wrong, not proof that they are wrong. Is there evidence to support the idea that new technology is pro, not anti-urban? Well, the futurists of the 19th century also thought that telephones would reduce urbanization. They didn't. More urbanized countries used more phones, even holding income constant. As the telephone spread during the 20th century, urbanization didn't slow one whit. A second piece of evidence comes from the location of industry. If technology made cities irrelevant, then we should expect to see technology-intensive industries locating far away from urban centers. They don't. Skill and technology-intensive industries are more likely to locate in the urban core than other industries. The most famous example of industrial concentration today, Silicon Valley, is the home of the world's most cutting-edge technology. Every aspiring software genius knows that they need to be physically there in the midst of the action, not just connecting in cyberspace. Of all the companies in the world, Google should be best at enabling long-distance working. So if electronic interactions made face-to-face interactions obsolete, we should expect to see that Google just sent their workers home. But instead, Google buys the Googleplex and tries to make sure that its workers are right next to each other all of the time. They buy 1.5 million square feet in downtown Manhattan. They tear down walls between workers to enable more interactions, just like Michael Bloomberg did in New York City Hall. Obviously, Google thinks the connecting in person is a crucial part of creativity. So did Marissa Mayer at Yahoo when she banned telecommuting in her attempt to turn that company around. I'm not saying that long-distance work doesn't sometimes make sense. The economist Nicholas Bloom found that productivity rose in a Chinese travel agency when that agency switched to telecommuting. But booking trips doesn't require all that much creativity. You can do an old job well at home, but it is much harder to learn how to do your next job when you're alone. I can write old ideas perfectly well at my home office, but to come up with something new, I need to be around my colleagues and students. The final piece of evidence supporting the view that cities have nothing to fear from technology is the path of cities during the 25 years since the futurists made their prediction of imminent demise. Cities didn't die, they thrived. The denser parts of America have seen income, housing prices, and population rise steadily relative to the less dense parts of America. The growth of cities has been even more spectacular in the developing world. I'm not claiming that I can tell the future. Maybe some future beam-me-up Scotty technology will make cities obsolete. But for right now, I think that the best guess is that further improvements in the internet and iPhones and electronic connectivity will only make cities stronger.